It's time again for another episode of DevOps Driving. I'm Scott Moore, your host. Thank you for joining me. It's 2024. What are the biggest problems implementing DevOps as an operating model? And can AI help us solve those problems? Will it make the developers and testers' lives more productive and easier? That's the subject for today's show. And my guest today has been a leading advocate for pure DevOps for many years and has led some of the largest efforts around its implementation in some of the biggest companies in the world. And he's seen rapid feedback and rapid results. I want you to meet Bryan Finster. Hey, Bryan, how are you today?
I'm doing good, Scott.
I'd like for you to give a brief introduction to our audience about who you are and what you do in DevOps.
Yeah, sure. So I'm Bryan Finster. I'm a value stream architect for Defense Unicorns. I've been a software developer for about three decades now.
Bryan, it's 2024. Are we there yet? I mean, or are there still issues implementing DevOps as an operating model?
There's a lot of companies who think they're using the DevOps operating model because they hire DevOps engineers and then they go out and deploy something to the cloud. The DevOps operating model really requires us to improve the communication infrastructure through the organization. How do we remove handoffs? How do we improve how information flows so we can get faster feedback and lower the cost of change so we can even accelerate feedback even faster? Most companies think that DevOps is delivery platforms. And so, no, we're not there yet at all.
As you know, the developer experience is front and center right now, and we hear a lot about cognitive overload. Will AI help relieve some of that load?
Yeah, so developer experience is very important. And really, when you think about developer experience, you need to think about all the paper cuts everybody has to go through every single day just to get their work done. And how do you just make that less painful? One of the big problems with the DevOps, the way DevOps is implemented in some places, is people think that you build it, you run it, means that I have to own all the things that require me to build and run it, instead of me as a product team being responsible for having a product and making sure that it's operating correctly, while I have platform teams making that easy for me to do, but not doing for me, if you follow me. There's a division of labor there that has to happen. It has to happen at the correct level. I look at the experiments, and so I've been running experiments with different ways, different use cases of using AI as a platform tool, because that's what I work on, is how do we improve developer experience? I work on developer platforms. And the experience I've had so far has been that there's two use cases I've really been focusing on. One is, how do we make documentation easier? Because if you want good developer experience, you have to get documentation so people can onboard quickly and discover things easily. And done properly, I believe language models make documentation far more accessible. You won't have to dig around for hours trying to find information. You can ask it a question, it'll pop up.
One of the things I've heard you talk about is specialists staying out of the way of developers to keep the process and the flow at maximum speed. So how do specialists help enable the developers and still function within an organization?
It's automation and education. Every specialist out there should be creating automation to make their specialty accessible and then providing information to offer training to people that need information on how to do that better. And also, reviewing the outcomes and giving feedback, but they can't be doing for me. So if you're a performance engineer, create a set of tools that I can easily wire into my platform, into my pipelines, so I can do performance testing and make sure it's fast and repeatable. But also provide tips and tricks on how to do that better that I can access through the LLM.
So how have things changed in your approach to solving problems before AI and after using AI?
But I will say that a year ago I was highly skeptical. And the experiments I've been running personally over the last couple of months and the feedback I've been getting from my peers have made me switch gears on that. You do have to know what you're doing. It doesn't replace knowledge. But I'm thinking in the very near future, this would be my primary development workflow. Is leveraging an LLM for code generation. It's just so much faster. I mean, when I was doing that experiment I talked to you about, it pulled in a library I didn't even know existed for drag and drop. And I, 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 I didn't have to find the library and I didn't have to learn the API to implement drag and drop. I had drag and drop implemented in less than a second. Before I knew about the AI, if I need to, before using that, I would do what I always do. It's like, oh, I need drag and drop. So I go Google on about drag and drop, or we go to NPM and look around for drag and drop libraries. I'll go figure out which ones people use most frequently. I'll go research the API. I'll go try to figure out. It would take me several days to go and implement that, just that one behavior, if I hadn't done it before. And this is super common. Mm-hmm. With this, it did it. That particular thing worked. So I didn't have to do anything else. I was like, oh, okay, that's a good library. You know, I can go later and see if I agree with the security profile of that library. But functionally, I had what I needed immediately.
So tell me your favorite story about DevOps and the success you've personally seen.
I worked for Walmart for a long time. And the last role I had at Walmart was working in the DevOps dojo. And our goal was to teach teams how to do continuous delivery. And we would do that by embedding in a team as engineers and pairing with the team. And the amount of joy that teams would get after not very many weeks of pairing with us and learning that CI and then later CD would make their work life better, you know, that's the thing I really enjoy. I really enjoy seeing people have that aha moment and understanding their life doesn't have to suck. Mm-hmm. That coding doesn't have to be pain all of the time, that you can get faster feedback and enjoy this, honestly addictive amount of delivery.
Yeah, I find also that just personally, I get more joy out of seeing somebody else being successful with something that I've shared with them than actually doing it myself. I didn't think that would ever be possible, but I actually do enjoy that more.
People use a lot of my content and they tell me it was helpful. And so I get this constant feedback of what you did helped me, which is the reason I'm a software developer. Because there's several things that I've done personally with delivering software that's literally changed people's lives. And that's why I do it. I don't honestly care about the code other than the fact that it solves a problem.
Thanks for being on the show, Bryan.
Yeah, absolutely. It was a pleasure. Thank you.
You know, Bryan talks a lot about getting back to the roots of pure DevOps. And a lot of companies seem to be getting that wrong. It's not just about writing code when we talk about the dev in DevOps. It's about product development. It's about creating an hypothesis and seeing if that hypothesis is right as fast as possible to see if it's providing value or if you need to pivot and change directions. If you want to find out more about Bryan and the work he does, check out bryanfinster.com or connect with him on LinkedIn. For this episode of DevOps Driving, this is Scott Moore. Thank you for joining me, and we'll see you next time.